Hi, I'm Kamon Reynolds, and in this video, we're going to show you how you can catch some freebies, how you can just set up some swarm traps, and we're going to talk about dimensions, we're going to talk about different types of lures out there, things that you can do that's a little bit cheaper, and what we do. Now, back when I was doing a lot of this, and I was not having hundreds of hives to manage, between my buddy and I, we would average 60% on over 46 traps that we had set out, which I think is pretty good. You'll never get 100, well, I never say never with beekeeping. There's been some locations like last year where I caught two in the same location. I pulled one of these boxes down with about 10 frames of bees, put one back up, and within 10 days I had caught another one. Because sometimes what a hive will do is they'll swarm once and then they'll swarm again. That's called an after swarm. Now, if it's your hive doing that, that is not good because you're gonna have very few bees left in that hive. However, always be prepared to catch a swarm, whether it's catching them in a swarm trap or just having a spare box ready to catch a swarm, because swarm season is action-packed. And for us, that usually starts sometime in late March all the way through April to May. However, last year I caught my first one in a swarm trap the first week of March. So that brings me to my first topic. Be prepared. I don't know where you live. It depends. But if you think your bees swarm a lot in April, then you need to have those swarm traps up by March 1st, and etc. You know, if you're up north and it's later, or if you're down south, you're going to have to adjust it for your season. However, I find that most of our swarming goes on here around the first week of April, but it depends on the year. It depends on a lot of different things. So always be prepared. Sorry, I had to throw a bee pun in there. And have those swarm traps up early. I already have mine up. I leave them hanging usually through the winter. Now this is one right here that's been pulled down. It caught a nice swarm. We took the bees out of it. I'm fixing to show you a lot of different things down in here, but real quick, let me knock a couple things out. So first of all, why do we want to catch them in this form or fashion? One, because it's easy and it works very good. Now, bees in the wild, they don't just like, hey, you know, here's a hole somewhere. Now they do that sometimes, but typically what they are looking for is a cavity that's good, and then on top of that has some old comb residue or something like that. And there's multiple reasons why bees prefer to go into that, but if there's not any damage to the combs, it is a big help to the colony. Bees spend so much of their resources drawing out combs, and so if there's already a bunch of combs from where a colony has died, which happens a lot more than people think, then the bees are going to be attracted to that because it saves them a lot of energy and it has all that bee smell. Remember, bees run off of pheromones, and so there's a lot left over in combs, and that is why there is nothing better to draw in a swarm than having some beeswax and propolis and old pieces of wood. I honestly think the older combs the better, and I think swarms would agree. Young combs really just don't have as much brood smell to them. So, but you can use swarm traps without combs. A lot of people start out and don't have it at all. So there's other lures that you can use as well. But if you already have some old combs, don't melt all of those down. Save some of those drone combs or whatever and stick one of them in there. Usually on my swarm traps, I'll have one comb in there like this. And you can just smell it. And if you can smell it, the bees sure can. They're extremely good at finding swarm trap places and resources. It's just amazing how good they are at finding that. But comb is number one. Get some propolis. And if you don't have a comb to put in there, but you have a little bit of beeswax or propolis from where you've scraped some of your equipment or something like that, you can't afford to give a frame, just use a little bit of that stuff. It really helps. You can just sprinkle it at the bottom board. The other thing is slum gum like this. Let me pull this out. So if you are extracting honey and after you've pulled a lot of your wax out, you're going to end up, there's still a little wax in there that can be rendered, but there's just a lot of propolis and there's even a little bit of honey in there. Now don't stick the whole block in there, of course, but you can take little bits of this and just chunk it up into little pieces. Yeah, there we go. Just like that. Oh yeah, and then you can just crumble that up and stick it in the hive, and that will help lure the bees into the hive as well. We want those hive smells. Now, if you don't have any of those things, or even if you do, I typically do all of those things because I feel like the more I have, the better it is, except when it comes to this stuff. Now, this is Swarm Commander. I typically use lemongrass, Lemongrasses work exceptionally well for me, but some people have said this works really good. I tried it out last year and did a pretty good job. I'm going to leave a link below in the comments if you would like to try this out, or some lemongrass that I've tried that works very well. But one of the things that you'll have to be careful with, and some people don't know this, is even though this really does help lure the bees in, if you put too much in there, it'll actually be more off-putting than it is helpful. We're trying to mimic the nazanov, or however you pronounce that, it probably depends where you're at, pheromone that the bees put out, and lemongrass is one of the closest things in the world to that smell. So when we put a little bit in the hive, it really can help lure them. However, this stuff is really strong smelling, and there's been a lot of beekeepers that I know and trust who have said if they put too much in there, it actually discourages the bees from going in, or, and I've seen this happen before, the bees will cluster underneath because they want to go in there, but it's just so strong smelling. This is another reason why I feel like too much essential oils in your feeds, especially during a queen introduction, might not be the best idea, but that's just my opinion. But yes, so a little bit of this. So how much is too much? Well, opinions are like noses, and we all have one. But me personally, I want to take a cotton ball or a rag or a little rag or, you know, paper towel, and I want to spritz once on that, and I want to stick it in the entrance, and then I like to have one on top of the frames up in the hive. And then I'm going to want to do that, maybe rebait the bottom one every 2 to 3 weeks. Now, I'll be honest with you, I'm too busy for that. I usually bait it once and then that's all we can do. But that works very well for me. Another thing to consider is habitat. Some areas of the country, being the United States and just around the world, the habitat for the bees is not near as good. So there's going to be better swarming areas than others. And then there's folks that live around commercial beekeepers and areas where just a lot of professional beekeepers are at, or a lot of beekeepers are at. And some beekeepers are not really good at keeping their hives from swarming. It happens. We've all been there. But even the professionals, sometimes they just... I know I lose swarms every year. Just sometimes you just lose swarms. You don't get the stuff. Years are different. Those bees go flying out, and they might go into your swarm trap. And honestly, it'd be better they went in your swarm trap than going to a cavity that's too small or into somebody's house or something like that. Now, if you're an Africanized bee area... you want to be very careful because those things can be a little rough. I don't have a lot of experience with those, but just be careful if you're in an area that has a lot of Africanized bees and take the necessary precautions. So, again, make sure you get them up quick. You want to hang them up early. Now, what about size on your swarm traps? This is a big topic, and it's highly debated between beekeepers. Me, personally, I want 10 frame. And by the way, at the end of the video, I'm going to have a link to a free bee book where you can get a copy of one of the best researches books on swarming and bee behavior. So I'll talk about that in a little bit. But me personally, and research has shown that you want to have at least a 10 frame deep box size for optimal attraction. I've heard a little bit bigger than the deep actually is better, but I'm trying to marry the perfect thing ideally for the bees, and also what is good for me. And there's a lot of different ways to catch swarms. Some people just hang up a box and put some, you know, little bits of comb or some lemongrass or whatever in there, and they just let the bees come in. But the problem with that is if you wait just 3 or 4 days, they build all that out, and then you can lose brood and resources and all that valuable comb. Now, some people will tie that up. I really don't have time for that, but that does work. Me personally, I would rather take a little bit more time and have some frames in there. You don't have to have combs, but what you can do is have empty combs. Make sure it's level. So this one up here would not work. But make sure that box is level up there, and you can have some starter strips or some wax or just something that's going to give them a good starting point. And that way you can still use the combs. And I have done that, and it does work. Sometimes they get them off center just a little bit. But overall, it's worked a lot better than just having to cut all that comb out. But some people are okay with doing that. So there are several different ways to do it. Me personally, I want to go to this thing. I want to shut the thing up, and then I want to be able to take it off the stand and put one back up. And hey, I've got a really cool video on doing all of that. It's one of our earliest videos. I'm going to leave that right up here. And it shows you the whole process of pulling the bees down, putting them back up, and then also fooling with the bees later and seeing what we have. And we got actually honey off of that colony the first year. Pretty Awesome. So what about the entrance? Well, ideally you want a good size hole about yay big. Now there's some research on this as well. And real quick, I want to say about all that research is, yes, I'm sure there are ideals out there, but nature does not give the bees ideals. It really does not. A lot of times you'll see a nice big cluster. I've seen them go into a cavity size that's hardly bigger than a 3 or 4 liters. But they'll go in there because they're desperate and they can't find anything better in their area. So the bees will do a lot of interesting different things. That's not going to be as ideal as me giving them a Langstroth 10 frame deep. Now some people are like, well, I use 8 frames or I only use mediums. We'll use 2 mediums maybe. Or, you know, some people are like 5 frame nukes. And I know some fellas that do 5 frame and then a 5 frame on top and they'll have them strapped together. There's some products out there where they actually have like corrugated plastic 5 frame nukes and all kinds of different things. So you've got to decide what you want to do. But the reason I want a 10 framer is because I know that the prime swarms that I catch in early spring, they're way too big for a 5-frame nuke. The biggest swarms will take over 12 to 15 frames of bees. Now, they will go into a hive like this, but they have to be pulled out within a fairly short period or they're going to swarm again. And I have literally caught swarms that took 2 deep boxes. And just bees hanging all out. Now, likely that was from a beekeeper because usually that's how hives get that large. But bigger cavities are more helpful, and I believe that if you have a really small nuke or something like that, then if it's a big swarm, they're going to look at that like the cavity size isn't really that big. That is debatable. I don't know. They still might come and hang off of it. I don't really know. One thing you can do to lure bees in is a queen tincture, and what is that? So we have a lot of queens. We go through queens a lot. Queens get old. Something happens. We find queens, or we have to kill queens and replace them when they, like we have one that was a drone layer. We take that, stick it in some alcohol. You can do like vodka, kind of like the whole vanilla bean deal. I don't know if you know about that, but they take vanilla beans and they extract the essence basically of the vanilla with the alcohol. You can do the same thing using the same type of alcohol and stick queens in there. Helps extract the pheromones from the mandible area and all of the other stuff that she produces. So you can actually take that and over time collect a bunch of queens in there, and then there are people who will take a cotton ball and put that in there as well, so it has some queen pheromone in there, which is a great idea. I've actually got some of those queens in a jar. So now height, this is where it gets interesting, because it's better if it's way up there. We want it about, and it depends on where you're, you know, what you want to do. I know some guys that put them in deer stands are supposed to be, I think, about, what is it, 15 feet, something like that. You'll have to read the book I'm fixing to recommend. I've read it twice, but I cannot remember. That's why I have to keep reading it over and over again. Lots of information in the book. I don't put them taller than this. Actually, most of mine are, when I'm standing on the ground, about chest to shoulder height, because I don't want to blow my back out or hurt myself or take the time primarily. And I've never had an issue. Some of the earliest swarms that I've caught prior to getting the swarm traps was just bee equipment that I had in my shed. I've had them before where I just had them boxes stacked up. I come over there, I'm like, goodness, there must have been a frame of honey in there. They're robbing that out. You start pulling that apart and there's a queen in there laying and all kinds of stuff. And you're like, yes. And of course, and you're just like, wait a second. And then, you know, swarm trapping, you know, it works great. And then I've had it before where there's just dead outs in the yard. You lost a colony or something like that. Left it on the stand a foot and a half off the ground, if that, and the bees will go into it. The main thing is a good cavity size and the bees being attracted to it. Having the height is important too, but really I've never had a problem with keeping them around the 4 foot, 3.5 foot, 5 foot area. And that way I don't have to do anything crazy to get those bees down. Let me tell you, when a 10 frame deep is full of honey and bees, it's pretty stinking heavy. You're probably talking somewhere around the 80 pound area, you know, maybe 70, 80 pounds. So that's pretty much, I think, everything. Now, as far as that book goes, I almost forgot about one more thing. We usually take some dead bees and throw in there as well. It's very common, I'm sure, for wild swarm dead outs out in the woods to have dead bees from when the colony perished in the bottom of the hive. And bees have some pheromones that they hold in with them, just, you know, hive smell. I'm sure there's a lot of stuff we don't even know. So we usually take a decent bit of dead bees and we throw them in as well. Might as well. And, you know, just those little bitty things, I think, that really add up to mimic kind of those wild conditions. So I think we've got all that. Why don't we use frame? Come to frame ratio. So as far as, where to hang. This is a hangout, man. So stick it somewhere where it's not deep in the woods. I have noticed, and a lot of other people have as well, when you have them at the edge of a wood line, tree line, they work a lot better than if you had it like an acre deep into the woods. Now, if there's like a clearing or something, the bees can get easy access. The bees don't need to be flying through all kinds of, you know, cedar trees and brush to be able to get to their hive. It really is a deterrent to the colony to want to go into an area like that. So I would put them more towards a tree line. So by the way, if you want to get that book that I was recommending, you can get it for free, and you can get that at Audible. That's what I did to get my second copy. And the cool thing is you don't have to pay a dime for it. If you'll go through our link in the comments below, you can try the free trial. You don't pay a thing. And if you like it, you can keep it. But if you don't, then you get to indefinitely keep that download and listen to it immediately, or listen to it 5 years from now. But it is Dr. Thomas Seeley's book, The Honeybee Democracy. And it is an extremely good book on how the bees decide to swarm, what they're looking for, the ideal conditions for, there's some good swarm trap plans in there. And it goes through, I mean, research all the way from, you know, the World War II era to how it built up to where we are now. It is awesome. I really enjoy Dr. Thomas Seeley's stuff. So you need to check that out. It's, again, it's free. So go through that link below, and you can also support our channel at the same time. So thanks for watching our videos. And if you have any comments or questions, leave them below.